Enjoy the platform to share our views. So this is Mr. Arvind Singh, the founder and chief executive officer of Singapore-based Quest on the Frontier. Now, he has nearly two decades of experience in corporate banking and risk management and then moved on to create his own enterprise. Now, Quest is an established regional boutique, executive search, corporate training and conferences firm that has a regional presence with seven offices in Asia. So everybody, could you please put your hands together for Mr. Arvind Singh.
Good morning, everyone. Someone asked me just before this conversation, this start, why did we do it? Why did we start? Why did I and my team started working on this? And the beginning was we have a boutique executive search unit. And what we were finding that male candidates who were suitable for those senior roles were often very willing to explore. And we found that sometimes female candidates who were very capable and very ready for the roles needed more time and persuasion. And we were struggling with this. And I remember asking one of the regional HR heads of a large company, and I said, is it just because we are an agency, we can't persuade people? Or people are not wanting to move across it to another organization? And this regional, very experienced HR person said, actually, this is a problem I have even internally. I have many more men walking into my office and asking for a raise they don't deserve. And I'm often spending more time with my female colleagues whom I need to persuade, you are ready for the job, take it. And that, I think, it was the genesis of the idea that we said, look, what are you doing to support this part? And they said, look, there are some efforts here and there, and I guess that also was the year, I must say, that we were about to have the first female US president. We were supposed to, 2016. So there was a buildup of women leadership, et cetera, and we said we should. So that's how we started. And when we looked around, we said companies have a specific initiatives within. But the challenge is there was a lack of a bigger platform and where people can come and talk to each other. And we said, okay, maybe this is something we can take lead and get started. Because quite often, the consensus becomes easier when you go and talk to people like yourself. And otherwise, you think maybe it's only my company, it's my business, this is an issue for me or not an issue for me. But when you go and talk to people, other companies from different industries, sometimes different, in terms of parent ownership, different type of companies, and you realize this is a bigger issue. And also, it gives a format for we had a target that we will have a better men participation, and I can see from the room we have not done very well. I think the ideal part would be, I was telling my team, ideally should be at least 40-50% men. So maybe next year we should have a discounted price for men so that there's more men participation, because I firmly believe this is not a women's issue. This is our issue. This is everyone's concern. It is a business imperative for large organizations. It is something that we have to do and we must do. And hence, the forum is on the third year this year, and we certainly hope to build on, and I'm very happy to see nearly full house. Some people are still coming on their way for the day. So that's one part. The second question is, and I'm sure a lot of research has happened on this subject, does diversity in general and gender diversity, does it matter? And I guess that debate has been settled. There are a lot of data to show it does matter. But I would like to also say that, look, it is not the gender diversity only that shows that just having numbers makes a difference. I think to some extent, at a large extent, diversity shows a mindset of an organization. Diversity shows an acceptance of different point of views. Diversity shows willingness to work and collaborate with people not like us. So whether it's the gender or other parts of diversity, I would imagine that people would argue that there is a high correlation between companies that have more female leaders versus those that don't. FT has a number of research papers out, number of other companies have. But I would submit that perhaps that could be what they call not a causal correlation, it may be just a casual correlation. The real correlation is the diversity shows the mindset of an organization. And hence, why these organizations do better? They're able to provide a better environment for all their stakeholders. For their employees, because employees feel their experience more enriching, they are able to attract better people. So the whole search for talent, which everybody's talking about, companies that have an open mindset would get it. In terms of a decision making, just having diverse views on a table makes the companies and individuals to make a better decision. You can look after your customers better because then your organization reflects the wider population. And the wider population, all these different elements are there. So we do believe that diversity has an impact, but at least my personal belief is it is not just direct part, but it's more in the context of a creating a right environment. Which leads me to the related point about, you know, people talk about diversity and inclusion. And I think you all are, most, you know, many of you are D&I experts, so I can't, you know, I'm sure you obviously know much more than me, but I would say that someone rightly said, diversity is probably more of a number you can say, but inclusion is the spirit where people feel included and participate actively. So diversity as a number is important, but more important is creating a culture where everybody feels welcome to contribute and to grow and realize their fullest potential. Now, organization obviously do realize that to change the culture, you also often need some policies, but policies alone can't change the culture. There's always, but you still need some cases, some nudge factor, you know, do something to nudge to change the part. And I think some companies in Australia, I believe, for example, there's a stereotypes. And when I say stereotypes, even many companies, we recently did a similar workshop in China on March 9th. And one of the things we found that many companies have policies on their book, but the utilization was an issue. So we have this, we have this, we tick the box, but utilization was the issue. And you ask why, and then anecdotally, and again, we're doing a more detailed research as we speak, anecdotally what we found that you go to your boss, and the boss says, yeah, there's a policy, you can work from home because you had a young family, you can work from home 6 months or whatever, I will not deny you. But it sends bad optics to your rest of the management team. It may be you're not serious about your job. So that's off the record, but but that is what the operative word is. And this person said, okay, maybe unless I, you know, it will be not very career enhancing move for me. So she did not avail of that. So there's an element of policies which is necessary, but also utilization has to be there. So at the end of the day, when you have the policies on board, it is important to do that. The last point I wanted to make was, at least in the part of the world we live and operate, there are no conscious biases. You know, we are thankful there are some parts of the world where there are still conscious biases. But unconscious biases are no less powerful. And many a times, you know, intellectually we will all agree, but there are challenges in terms of overcoming it. And I'm sure most of you would have heard or this whole story about how the women musicians got a high proportion in the orchestra was a very insightful one. And I'll just repeat, even if some of you might have heard before. In 70s, I believe, 94% of the musicians and orchestra in Europe were men. And the maestro said, look, women play excellent music. Why don't we get them? And they went out and tried to recruit them, but somehow the numbers were not changing. Then one wise man said, you know what, maybe we should not do audition in open. We should do audition behind a curtain. So we are focusing on the music and not the musician. So did that, the curtain was placed, and things improved, but not too much. Then they said, what is the issue? We can't see them. And then somebody said, maybe, you know what, let me try something else. Next audition we will do, we will put a carpet. And what his insight was, it was a wooden floor that you were doing audition behind. So when someone walks, you get a cue about whether that's a male or a female. So when they did the audition on a carpet behind a curtain, the numbers went up. And I checked was some 54% people in the orchestra, or maybe even higher, are women now. So simply, organizations have to make conscious effort to put these curtains and carpets to overcome the unconscious bias. Deliberately, nobody wants to differentiate, but this is deep built in within our system. So I think that I will close my remarks. I guess the day is full of great agenda. You know, we have a number of familiar subject topics as previous years. We also have some new topics this year, specifically to talk about how to encourage women's participation in science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM, because that's a new growth area. I welcome you all once again, and I hope you have a really enjoyable day. Thank you.